Hello, students. The theme of our lecture is language is a mirror of culture. The real world, culture and language, their relationship and interaction.
The plan of the lecture consists of the picture of the world created by language and culture, language as the instrument of culture, the role of language in person formation, language and national character, culture and system of norms, the language and mentality. Picture of the world created by language and culture. Let us dwell on a relationship and interaction of language and reality, language and culture. These issues play a crucial role for improving forms and efficiency of communication and for the teaching of foreign languages. Their neglect explains many failures in international relations and in education. Language is a mirror of the world. It reflects reality and creates a picture of the world, specific and unique for each language and consequently for people, ethnic group, speech group, which use this language as a means of communication. A comparison of language with a mirror is right. It really represents the world around us. Every word is an object or phenomena of the real world. Language reflects everything, the geography, climate, history, living conditions. For instance, there is the famous linguistic folklore example of many synonymous with the word white, between 14 and 20 according to different sources, to indicate the different colors and types of snow in a unique language. Also, there are several designations for the word camel in Arabic language, some name for a tired camel, the pregnant camels, and etc. In Russian language, for obvious reasons, there are several designations for the word connected with snow in winter. Пурга, метель, буран, снежная буря, вьюга, поземка. But in English, this diversity is denoted by snowstorm, which is quite enough to describe all the problems with snow in the English-speaking world. The correlation between the real world and language can be represented as follows. Real world, language, the subject, a phenomenon, and word. However, between world and language as a thoughtful man and native speaker, the close relationship and interdependence between language and its speakers is not in doubt. Language is an instrument for communication between people and is inextricably linked with the life and development of the speech group, which it's used as a means of communication. Social nature of language reveals both an external conditions of its functioning in this society by and polylingualism, conditions for language learning, the level of society, science and literature development, and etc. And in the structure of language, its syntax, grammar, vocabulary, functional stylistics, and etc. Further, on a material of English and Russian languages, we will show the human influence on a language and modern role of language in a formation of personality and character, both individual and national one. So there is a man between language and real world. That man perceives and understands the world through the senses, and on that basis establishes a system of representations of the world. Passing it through his consciousness and conceiving the results of his perception, he transmits it to other members of speech group with the use of language. In other words, there is thinking between reality and language. Language is a way to express the idea and transmit it from person to person, closely connected with thinking. The correlation between language and thinking is an eternal and complicated question of linguistics and philosophy. But for us, the main thing is clear. Close relationship and interdependence of language and thinking and their relation with the culture and reality. A word reflects not the subject of reality, but its image connected with conception and notion which the native speaker has in his mind. And the concept is forming on a level of generalization of some basic features, and therefore it represents an abstraction, diversion of specific traits. The way from the real world to its concept and further verbal expression is different for different nations because of different in history, geography, and peculiarities of life of these peoples, and consequently the difference in their social consciousness as well. Since our consciousness is determined as collective, way of life, customs, traditions, etc., for example, culture and root, ethnographic sense, an individual, the specific perception of the world peculiar to a particular individual. So the language reflects the reality directly, but though two zigzags, from the real world to thinking, and from thinking to language. Thus, language, thinking, and culture are so closely interconnected that make a single whole consisting of these three components, any of which cannot function, and consequently, and to exist, without two others. Altogether, they correspond with the real world, oppose it, depend on it, reflect, and simultaneously form it. We can see this correlation in the following scheme. thinking, culture, language, speech, subject, the phenomena, concept, notion, and word. So the world surrounding the main is presented in three forms: a real picture of the world, cultural or conceptual picture of the world, a language picture of the world. The real picture of the world is an objective extra-human reality. It is the world surrounding a person. The cultural or conceptual picture of the world is a reflection of real picture through a prism of the notions generated on a base of conceptions of the person received by means of sense organs and a transmitted through its consciousness, both collective and individual. The cultural picture of the world is specific and differs for the different nations. It is caused by many factors, such as like geography, climate, environment, history, the social organization, beliefs, tradition, way of life, and etc. Language as the instrument of culture. The role of language in person formation, language and national character. Language and man are inseparable. Language does not exist out of the person, and the person as Homo sapiens does not exist out of language. Respectively, a man cannot be studied out of a language, and a language cannot be studied out of man. Language reflects the world surrounding man. Language also reflects the culture created by man, keeps it for man, and transfers from man to man, from parents to children. Language is an instrument of cognition with help of which man learns world and culture. At last, language is an instrument of culture. It forms the person, defines his behavior, way of life, outlook, mentality, national character, and ideology. Language is a strict and incorruptible teacher. It imposes the ideas, representations, models of cultural conception and behavior. Psychologists, culturologists, sociologists wrote a lot on a relationship of notional culture and personality. Vyrotchagin and Kustomarov, in their book Language and Culture, say, man is born neither Russian, nor German, nor Japanese, etc., but they become them due to national community of people they belong to. Raising a child passes through the impact of national culture of surrounding people. From the first minute a man hears the sound of their future language, language acquaints him with world around, imposing him that picture which have drawn before. At the same time, through the language a person gets idea about a world and society, about its culture, systems of values, morals, behavior, and etc. The language reflects the world and culture and forms native speakers. Each national language not only reflects but also builds up the national character. In other words, if language forms the representative of the nation, the native speaker, it plays the same constructive role in formation of national character. Culture and system of norms. Members of each society are deeply immersed in their own beliefs and customs and do not notice that they obey them too, considering them the only right and reasonable ones. When a culture points how and what should or should not we do, it is called normative, so it points out the standards of correct behavior. In order to exist in the social world, a man must communicate and collaborate with other people. But for a successful realization of this action, people should have a general idea what to do and how to do it correctly. Thus, man as social creature should work out a set of generally accepted patterns of behavior in order to live in society and interact with other individuals. Such patterns of behavior in society, regulating this behavior in a certain direction, are called social norms. So, to shake hand, we extend the right hand. In a store, we stand in a queue. We don't speak loudly in a library. Through these actions, we follow these standard norms. Our culture defines that behavior as correct. At the same time, we may use either right or left hands for scratching the knee because our culture doesn't regulate this action. So the cultural norm is a system of behavior expectations, the way people are gonna act. It is obvious that such norms based on tasted people consent cannot be steady enough. Changes in society transform the conditions of human interaction. Therefore, some norms do not correspond to society requirements. They become useless. Moreover, outdated norms are hampering the further development of human relations. So people strive for change in it. The transformation of cultural norms may be realized in different ways. Some of them, for example, norms of etiquette, daily behavior, can be transformed rather easily, but norms of the most significant spheres of human activity, state laws, religious traditions, are usually transformed with great difficulties. Let's classify main types of norms. Customs. For men, one of the problems of social life is adaptation to reality and relation to other people. Everyone is trying to do everything possible to solve these problems. Gradually, society forms a set of functional patterns of behavior allowing to its members cooperating with environment and each other. For example, a person from a different social group can eat standing at a social event, lying as patricians of Roman Empire, or squatting cross-legged. He may eat alone or in company, use fork or hands, begin with wine and finish with fish, or vice versa. In Russia, women traditionally gave birth to children in hot heated baths, and in one of the South American Indian tribes, women gave birth hanging on trees. There are thousands of standard patterns of behavior through trial and error under the influence of other social groups or environment. The social group chooses one or several variants of behaviors, repeats, fixes it, and applies in everyday life. The successful patterns of behavior became ways of a life of these people, their culture and customs. Therefore, customs are habitual, normal, most convenient, and widespread ways of group activity. Shaking the right hand, eating with fork, and right side traffic, coffee or tea for breakfast are examples of customs. New generations perceive these ways of a life partially by unconscious imitation, partially by conscious training from the child, and many surrounded by patterns of everyday customs. As he constantly sees these rules, they become the only correct and comprehensible for him. A child adopts these norms and growing takes it as something normal. For example, for a greeting, he automatically extends his right hand. Through earlier, this gesture meant the absence of weapon. Men having adopted norms of society or a social group take other customs as strange and impractical. So we do not understand the demureness in receiving guests of German families, and they also struck by the hospitality wasteful of Russians or Central Asia people. The number of customs in a society is rather great. Even the most primitive societies have thousand customs, and in a modern industrial society, their number considerably increases. Moral principles. Some customs accepted as a result of social practice in certain group or in a society are the most important because they affect safety, interests, and social order of a society. When we incorrectly use fork and knife is just an insignificant mistake. But in our society, it is abnormal to a woman to leave her family, her husband, and child. It affects the upbringing of the child, his health, and psychological condition. It is quite clear why the society aspires to avoid such infringements. Thus, we can distinguish two types of customs. The customs as patterns of good manners and politeness, essential customs for welfare of the society obligatory to follow. Such ideas connected to certain public ways of human existence, of that should do and should not we do, are called moral principles or ethical standards. Social experience of a human society shows that moral principles are not invented intentionally when someone recognizes something as a good idea. They arise gradually from an everyday life and human cooperation without a conscious choice and mental efforts. Moral principles are transmitted to future generations not as a system of practical benefits, but as a system of immutable sacred absolutes. As a result, moral norms firmly established and carried out automatically. In a society with firmly established moral principles and a clear system of a transmission to new generations, the moral injunctions are rarely violated. Institutional norms. The set of customs and norms relating to such important issues in the society as formation and functioning of families in a society, government, education, distribution of products, etc., embody in its social institutions. Institutional norms differ from customs by their consciously and carefully developed informal or informal code. Besides, there is a circle of people where each person takes part in maintenance and protection of these norms. Patterns of behavior, values, rituals, and traditions become interrelated in high standard. For example, banks, trading organizations, or the economic institutes supporting their own norm standards. Standard codes of these institutes develop gradually from customs and the ethical standards of a simple exchange that make them the most formal and inseparable rules. Laws. While moral norms are based on moral interdictions and permissions, they may be reorganized in laws. People follow the moral norms automatically, but some people have a temptation to break moral norms. Such individuals may be subordinated by the threat of legalized punishment. The implementation of standards within the laws is provided by special institutions, such as police, court, prison, and etc. Anyone who doesn't follow the legalized moral norms is usually punished, isolated, or even destroyed. But each law can be effectively only when it supports those ethical standards which are firmly accepted by the majority of members of society. For example, the prohibition, Сухой закон, was inefficient because for many people it did not become the legalized moral and ethical standards. On the other hand, the law rarely satisfies all social groups. Unfortunately, we cannot accurately measure the degree of consistency between the existing laws and ethical standards to ensure that the law will be effective. It should be noted that in modern society, laws are means of regulation of not only a system of moral norms. A large number of laws are implemented to regulate, for example, industrial relations on trade. Мне снова прочитать, да? It should be noted that in modern society, laws are a means of regulation of not only a system of moral norms. A large number of laws are implemented to regulate, for example, industrial relations or trade. Language and mentality. The problem of correlation of language and thinking has a long history. For example, Sapir wrote the following about the language influence on thinking. People are living not only in an objective world of things, and not just in the world of social activity, as it is usually believed, but also under the influence of a particular language which presents a means of communication for this society. The real world is extensively constructed on a base of language norms of a given group. We see, hear, and perceive these or that phenomena due to the linguistic norms of our society. In other words, the character of reality cognition according to the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis depends on the language of the thinking subject. We dismember the nature, writes Whorf, in a direction prompted by our native language. In the world of phenomena, we make those categories and types not because they are obvious. On the contrary, the world appears as a kaleidoscopical stream of impressions which should be organized by our consciousness, and it means basically by the language system of our consciousness. So, language affects human thinking, outlook, mentality, and behavior. Basing on the fact that every language is means of thinking, and these means are different for people who speak different languages, we can assume that the picture of the world, for example, mentality, is not the same too for people from different human communities. The more differences in language systems, the more difference in a picture of the world. So educational approach should pay more attention to the specificity of the world perception of students, take into account these peculiarities. That is why in educational process, the accent should be made on native language. In the process of learning his mother tongue, a child forms a filter and perceives the world in certain categories. People divide the world, will organize it in concepts and make notions in the same way because they are participants of some agreement which is valid only for Kelvin language. At a present stage, the difference in world perception is obvious, but the theory and practice of education yet does not apply these peculiarities of cognition process. For example, in Russian, one verb is used for designation of different external actions. And in a language of Navajo Indian tribe, different verbs are used for the notion of different actions because its notion closely is connected with types of objects at which they are directed. There is a category of gender in Russian language, but Attic language has no this category. And we have to admit that all these peculiarities leave a mark on mind period of certain language. It is considered that in language studying we can mark two directions. The first is the vocabulary analysis, where the historical picture of the world of given nation is reflected. The second direction is the analysis of the grammatical structures that creates the framework for a national picture of the world formation. That means that historical events form the picture of the world according to the language borders. In Russian language, there is no firm word order in narrative sentences. Unlike Russian, a Deic language has fixed word order. Usual sentence construction is the following: a subject, an object, an adverbial modifier, and a predicate. Analyzing the specificity of Russian sentence structure, Melnikova supposed the following specifics of the world cognition at a psychological level. The world perception is unstructured and fuzzy. It is the world where everything can happen. This thought is confirming after analyzing substantial layer of Russian language, the specifics of the use of some small words. Native speakers of Russian language usually ascribe their and somebody achievements to some external elements of source. But that is not typical for European nations or for a native speaker of English. Furthermore, the perception of the world as an unstructured formation affected another feature of Russian discourse. The vocabulary structure of the Russian language is characterized by an abundance of ways for expression of uncertainties. In any case, this range is estimated positively. Its ideas are present in many Russian words such as хлебосольство, гостеприимство, радушие. Then, it is широкая душа, a generous and magnanimous person. Then, широта may be defined as a tolerance. The notion of широких взглядов means a progressive person. However, the notion of широкая натура can include extremes of some quality. The translator of these qualities implied by Russian generous nature is the language. So, a language is an integral part of culture. National peculiarities of thinking and behavior are fixed in language and reflected in it. Language in turn affects the understanding of the world and in a process of cognition, that is why educational process should take into account these facts. Culturonyms, general terms for linguistic units of different languages, assigned to elements of different cultures, Kabaki in his book The Practice of English Language and Intercultural Communication gives the detailed notion and a classification of it. As a universal means of communication, language creates a symbol for all, important for the people, elements of civilization which we can call culturonyms. Kabaki divides them into three main types, which are polyonyms, idionyms, and synonyms. According to definition, polyonyms are the universal elements of civilization, meaning in many cultures. Polyonyms may be different, heterogeneous in their forms. River, река, teacher, учитель, library, библиотека, government, правительство, or similar, homogeneous in form and meaning, geography, география, university, университет, army, армия, democracy, демократия. Idionyms are specific elements given internal cultures and language of these cultures. So cowboy, prairie, house of commons are the idioms for the English language. The Cossacks, steppe, the Duma, the Tsar are the idionyms for the Russian language. Synonyms are the language units used in given language for a designation of specific elements of external cultures. So words Cossack, steppe, Duma, Tsar are the synonyms within the limits of English language, while the cowboy, prairie, the house of commons, and to its similar are the synonyms within the limits of Russian. Besides these definitions of the cultural phenomena, other authors use synonymous definitions to a word, culturonyms, naming them as realities. For example, Bruce's definition, realities are the concepts concerning life, traditions, stories, material and spiritual culture of the given people. Berhudarev describes the realities as objects, concepts, and situations that do not exist in the practical experience of people who speak another language. He refers here to various kinds of material and spiritual culture peculiar only to this nation. Kazakova gives her definition of the word realities. Realities are the notion of national cultural object typical for the original culture and unknown for a translating culture. Schweitzer, in his work Theory of Translation, gives the following definition. Realities are the subjects or the phenomena connected with history, culture, economy, and life. Also, Komissarov, in a work, A Manual of Translation from English into Russian, gives the definition of realities as how the practicing translator most often has to resort to such techniques when he comes across some new coined words in a source text or deals with names of objects or phenomena unknown to a TL community, the so-called realia. Having generalized these definitions, we can determine realities as all language units, which is designating specific elements of the language without the equivalence in translated language. Thank you for your attention.